thrill of my whole musical career, the biggest highlight was being asked to join Thin Lizzy, you know?
Lizzy är mina största förebilder.
I'd say Phil Lynott is one of my, if not my favorite songwriter.
He was the Mike Tyson of rock and roll.
He was like a really brilliant showman.
We're kind of like brothers, you know, it's like two brothers can love each other, but they can hate each other and have fights and fall out.
Phil Lynott var det irländska rockbandet Thin Lizzys sångare, basist och ledare. Med en unik låtskrivartalang led han obehindrat mellan olika musikstilar. Som tonåring sjöng Phil i gruppen Black Eagles i Dublin. Där, på Christian Brothers School, träffade han en trummis.
We're back outside the school now, this is the entrance to the school. Actually, first seen Phil, he was in the class. When I actually first talked to him, he was right down there, that gate down there. And I happened to be just walking up here. And he said, hi, Brian, you know, he says, I was amazed when he said it. He said, I like the band, you know. I was playing with a band called the Liffey Beats. And I said, thanks, Phil, you know, I like your band too, the Black Eagles, you know. So we just went like that and we left it at that. So this really was the first time he said something to me, really, you know. But it was great because, I mean, he offered me the gig then, you know, with the Black Eagles not long after that. This place brings back memories, all right? It's unbelievable. Did look as depressing. It hasn't changed that much, really.
I ended up going to this club called the Countdown Club in Dublin. And I just sat down, like everybody else did in those days, and sat on the floor and rolled a spliff or something and just sat. I mean, everybody was doing it, you know. It was the culture of the time. And Brandani's drumming just started going, the sound and the style of his drumming, and I went, God almighty, man. I got to get that guy for my band. Whenever they took a break, there was only Philip and Bran. I could see them walking off the stage, walking across here, and going into the changing room, which was over there. And the other two guys didn't go in. So I sort of sat there and went, I wonder, should I go over and speak to these guys? And I got up and walked over to the changing room door and knocked on it. Come in. I walked in, Phil's sitting there, and Brian Downey's over there. And I says, hello, I'm Eric Bell.
Oh, Eric Bell, Gary Moore told me about you.
I said, oh, Gary, I know Gary a long time. He's a good, reasonably good, you know, a good friend of mine, you know. Turns around to Brian, he says, hey, Brian, you fancy forming a band with Eric? And Brian said, no. And I said, well, that's definitely it, you know. And Phil wouldn't let it go. He pushed him. He says, listen, Brian, Orphanage has went as far as it can go. He says, we've done the circuit loads of times. He says, why don't we start a new thing? So Brian said, I don't care, Phil. I do whatever you want to do. So Phil then approached me and he said, listen, me and Brian will form a group with you for two reasons we'll do it. And I said, what's that? He says, I want to play the bass. I don't want to be out the front singing all the time. I want to play the bass. He seemed so enthusiastic, Philip. You know, it was just bubbling off him, you know what I mean? Lots of energy. And he also said, and also if we can do one or two of my original songs. And we sat and listened to him and I said, Jesus, excellent. You know, right away, as soon as I heard him, I said, yeah. And that's how Thin Lizzy started. I'm a rocker. Down at the juke joint, me and the boys are stomping, bibbing and bopping and telling a dirty joke or two. Then walked this chick and I knew she was up for something, and I kissed her right there out of the blue. I said, hey baby, meet me, I'm a tough guy, got my sickle outside, you wanna try? She just looked at me and rolled them my big eyes and said, oh, I'd do anything for you, 'cause you're a rocker. That's right, I'm a rocker. I'm a rocker too.
Well, we're in Clontarf now, and it's Castle Avenue in Clontarf in Dublin. And this is the place where Eric and Phil used to live when we formed in 1969. And those three top windows up there, if you can see them, that's where we started rehearsing in there for the first album as well, you know. So This brings back a few memories, actually, all this place around here. But we used to go in there and rehearse every day, literally every day, for about 3 months to do the first album. People sleeping over and lots of parties, and people used to come down from town, you know, we used to sort of go in for a few drinks and meet people in town, and they all come back with a few drinks and beers and all the rest of it. And we'd end up having a session till about 5 or 6 in the morning. And I used to sort of crawl out of there, because I used to live in my mum's house in Crumlin, you know. And I used to crawl out of here at 6 o'clock in the morning and get a taxi home back to Crumlin. I very rarely stayed over here because I used to get into trouble if I stayed here too long, you know.
To be playing in a group, you had to be as good as you could be on your instrument. Because around those days you had Deep Purple, Ritchie Blackmore, fabulous, absolutely fabulous player, Jeff Beck, Eric Clapton, Pete Townshend, Peter Green, on and on and on and on. These guys were like really, really, really good players. And that's what was happening in those days. People were buying that type of music then, and the musicianship was frightening. Really, really frightening. You wouldn't walk on a stage in those days if you couldn't really play. And we had a chance to come to England to record our first album in England. And we recorded our first album in England. And then the manager said, right, lads, we're going to get you a few gigs in England to see how you go down with the audience. And we went, what? No. I was like this. Seriously, in the changing room? Because I thought outside it would be Peter Green, Jeff Beck, Eric Clapton, or their sisters, or their brothers, or their aunties. Honest to God, this was going through my head. Because now we are in England. Now we are in London. And it's very possible that those people are going to be here. Because we're actually in London, where it all happens. So, like, the three of us were, like, petrified playing in front of an English audience, because an English audience had seen the best, yeah? They had seen the best musicians that was around. And then we walk on from Ireland, like, you know what I mean? And it was really difficult, I tell you.
Oh, Eric's excellent. Excellent guitar player. You know, very, very underrated guitar player. You know, so underrated, I mean. From the first three albums, he played some incredible stuff on those albums. Incredible.
...1972 gör Thin Lizzy på skoj en rockversion av den gamla dryckesvisan Whiskey in the Jar. Det blir deras första hitlåt.
And then when Whiskey in a Jar happened, there's a price to be paid, you know? You just can't carry on the same way as you did, which is a pity.
Framgången med den lättsamma tolkningen av Whiskey in the Jar gör att Thin Lizzy betraktas som en popgrupp. Det spelar låten i trivsamma familjeprogram på TV. Eric Bell är frustrerad.
And I found it very hard to take. I didn't like the way I was becoming. One night I just basically cracked up. You know? We went on stage in Belfast and I was really, really, really drunk. Somebody should have taken me home instead of playing the guitar. And I went on stage and I just wasn't there, and it just became too much. I started sort of hallucinating, and threw my guitar up in the air and walked off, and that was it.
The guitar came crashing down on the stage, you know. It was just all this feedback happening, and I think the people actually thought it was part of the show, and they all started clapping, you know, which is like really amazing. But it wasn't part of the show at all. We were left as a two-piece band and on the stage in Belfast to finish off the gig, you know. Eric wouldn't come back on stage, so that really sticks in my mind. And then the next day we had to phone up Gary Moore in London to get him to fly over to play the rest of the tour, which is kind of amazing because we'd no rehearsals or nothing, and Gary just came in and played literally from scratch and just finished the tour off, you know, with no rehearsals. Kind of amazing.
Men problemen slutar inte med tillkomsten av den nya gitarristen. Det fortsätter med honom. Gary Moore fästas så hårt att han snart är utbränd och måste hoppa av. För Brian Downey och Phil Lynott får lösningen bli dubbla gitarrister.
Big Charlie was a school friend of mine, used to roadie for Lizzy. He said to Phil that he was looking for a guitar player at the time, obviously, because the band had sort of ground to a halt. And they were holding auditions in London. And Charlie kept saying to him, I know this guy, he's a friend of mine, you know, get him down. And then got the gig with Lizzy about the same week, actually.
Den andra gitarristen blir amerikanen Scott Gorham. Han och Brian Robertson tvinnar sina gitarrer i effektiva harmonier runt snygga melodier. Ett stilbildande koncept.
The norm back then, you got signed to a record company, and it was the norm that you probably won't do anything on your first album. You probably do a little bit better on your second one, but it's the third album that really counts. And if you don't make it by your third album, then you're out of there. So here we are, we're on our third album. We know that the guillotine is pretty well sharpened and it's ready to drop at any point here. So, you know, the pressure was on.
We already had the skeletons of, you know, a lot of the songs. None of them were by any means finished. So that's why we went in here. We tried to refine the songs. And we had about, I guess we worked up about 15 songs for that album. And at that point, The Boys Are Back in Town was one of the, say, five that's got sort of carved out that we probably weren't going to record in the studio. And the only reason that got saved was because Chris O'Donnell, one of the managers at the time, he heard the demo, and he was the one that said that he said, no, I there's something there on that song, I really like it. Why don't you carve out one of the other ones and actually go in the studio and record this one? And, you know, thank God he did, because it became a hit song, and it started everything for us. So it was kind of a close call that at the time.
Thin Lizzy har skapat sin egen lätt igenkännliga stil. Låtarna blir tuffare, men har fortfarande samma gränsöverskridande mångfald. Bandet turnerar skott som jämt.
And you could see that when we came back from the States and we did Seven Nights in Hammersmith on the trot, and the very first night, and we'd been away for 6 months. And the minute we hit The Boys Are Back in Town, the place erupted.
Down time, traveling all the old man you went to. The boys are back in town, boys.
Singeln The Boys Are Back in Town och albumet Jailbreak innebär det slutgiltiga genombrottet. Då kommer nästa dråpslag. Brian Robertson, det skotska brushuvudet, spårar ur.
On the very next album, Bad Reputation, all of a sudden you were missing on the sleeve.
Yeah.
There was Scott, Brian, Philip on the sleeve.
And no me.
And why was that?
To teach me a lesson.
Uh-huh.
Basically. I think it was Phil's idea, actually.
He was out of the band permanently, I think, in 1977. I think that was the ultimatum he was given, you know, he'd have to leave the band. As far as I can remember, I think he was invited back to play on Bad Reputation. But I don't think he was ever really invited back to play on a permanent basis with the band. So I think maybe around that time he was given the ultimatum, you know.
Because I got fired. Again. Probably a catalogue of things. It's just the way the band was going at the time, you know, and Phil and I were fighting quite a bit because I was drinking pretty heavily.
1978 släpps Live and Dangerous, ett dubbelt livealbum. Energin och atmosfären från några Thin Lizzy-konserter har fångats perfekt. Många tror att inspelningarna är gjorda i efterhand i en studio. Sanningen är att bara några få justeringar gjorts i efterhand. Så här bra var helt enkelt Thin Lizzy på 70-talets turnéer. Efter sparkningen av Brian Robertson återgår Gary Moore till Thin Lizzy. Albumet Black Rose spelas in 1979 och som vanligt målas omslaget av konstnären Jim Fitzpatrick, Phil Lynott's vän.
He asked me to work on an album he was doing called Vagabonds of the Western World. And I jumped at the chance. Did loads of roughs, sent them off and he loved them. And eventually we sorted it out as the cover that you've seen. And it was a great opportunity for me because I was doing work in Britain at the time. I'd worked for T-Rex, I'd even done a small job for Led Zeppelin, but I desperately wanted to work for an Irish band. And Irish bands in those days were crap. Do you know what I mean? Here was Thin Lizzy, like rock and roll, made for me. You know? I kind of like Johnny the Fox most, always have, because Philip always gave me total freedom, but sometimes the title restricts you. And in Black Rose, I mean, you know, I obviously wasn't going to do something, you know, to do with, you know, politics or something strange. I was going to go for an image relating to a rose, because the Black Rose is a metaphor for Ireland oppressed by the English. It's an Irish poem called Roisin Dubh. And in Johnny the Fox, I had a huge advantage because there was no title. The album was recorded and they were stuck. And I had done this border for something else for Philip. And he had always said that whenever we get a chance, we're going to use it. So I said, can I use the border? And he said, yep. So I used the board and I left that center circle vacant because I would ring him every like couple of days and say, have we got a title yet? You know, what am I supposed to put here? You know, and eventually he came up with Johnny the Fox. And there's no, you know, it's Johnny the Fox meets Jimmy the Weed is the correct title. So I had this, remember the nightlife thing with the panther overlooking the city? And I put a similar kind of thing with the fox, you know, because I like foxes anyway. But I like it. It's like a heavy metal Celtic border kind of thing. It's pretty weird.
Jailbreak hade släppts 1976. Var nere på den lokala skivbutiken i Märsta centrum. Och så såg jag där en skiva som stod då i det här skivracket då, grå. Med någon futuristisk, lite så här Star Trek-influerat kom ut. Och så plockade man upp den här så kunde man vika ut som ett album då. Och så var det urstansat i någon tv-monitor eller liknande som man kunde se vart den tredimensionella effekten. Så jag tyckte det var skitball konvolut då liksom. War of the Worlds, och så på med plattan och så lyssnade man. Så. var musiken ännu bättre. Det var mitt första minne.
My first band was called Obsession. We played we probably played about 3 or 4 Thin Lizzy songs. Awesome, amazing. I'd say Phil Lynott is one of my, if not my favorite songwriter. I think the stuff he wrote was amazing.
Hur har Thin Lizzy inspirerat dig?
De inspirerade mig otroligt mycket som låtskrivare, som gitarrist, sångare och allting liksom. Men det är Lizzy mina största förebilder.
Phil would take someone in his life or himself and just he'd write a song around it. It would be kind of it would be veiled, but not completely veiled. It would be transparent. You could see who he was on about. Like, you know, Parisian Walkways. It wasn't about Paris, it was about him. I remember Paris in 49. He was born in 49. His middle name's Paris. Things like that. He was always very clever in that way.
I remember Paris in 49.
Well, most of his lyrics are about people he loved or people he met, or there'd be stories of a happening in his life. I remember one of the first songs he wrote was Look What the Wind Just Blew In. And that was his first girlfriend that I was really aware of, that he was in love with. And he spent 6 years with her. Her name was Gail. And the word, and she came from the north of Ireland. So the words of the song was, look what the wind just blew in, this Gail from the north. His first daughter, Sarah, was When You Came In My Life.
When you came in my life, you changed my world, my Sarah. Everything seemed so right, my baby girl, my Sarah. You are all I want to know, you hold my heart, so don't let go. You are all I need to live, my love to you I'll give.
And Kathleen, my beautiful Irish girl Kathleen.
This song is for Kathleen.
And if ever you were driving along a highway with him, and he always kept a pad and a pen, and if you saw, especially in America, if you saw, he'd be driving along the highways and he'd see a poster, we say, of a cowboy with a Stetson on, and he'd write little quips down, and they'd come out in his songs.
And he could write different styles, you know, from, you know, he'd be influenced by wherever he was, you know, the cowboy song to completely traditional Irish to whatever, you know, more tribal kind of, you know, stuff about American Indians.
It was quite an interesting process to watch Phil and how he worked in the studio and how he would sometimes be doing a song and I'd be in the back room just watching and listening and thinking, man, I just don't see how this thing's gonna come together. And then he'd start laying his vocals down and harmonies and different things and all of a sudden the whole picture would come alive. It would be like he knew exactly where it was going and what he was doing. I mean, he was the leader of the gang, you know.
You are the only one I know who's been in a band and still says that the band, Thin Lizzy in this case, was better off without you with a different lineup.
Well, what I meant was that the classic lineup of the band was kind of everyone's favorite. And it was kind of, I mean, I liked that lineup of the band better because it meant I could go and see them, and I quite liked listening to the records like Jailbreak and all that stuff. And I just thought it worked better with Brian and Scott on guitar. It was just a more kind of sympathetic sort of chemistry between them. So, you know, it wasn't me being like falsely modest or anything, or saying that there were better guitarists than me or anything like that. I wasn't saying that, I just meant that as a band, I felt that it was better that way. It's not that he misses much, or even that he lost his lucky touch. It's just he gambles so much, and you know that it's wrong. Waiting for an alibi, waiting for an alibi, waiting just to catch your eye. Waiting for an alibi, waiting for an alibi. See, I told you.
Vad har Gary Moore betytt för dig?
Han är min största förebild som gitarrist. Liksom. Han är nummer ett. Han har alltid varit nummer ett för mig och fortfarande är nummer ett. För det är ingen annan som spelar med så mycket känsla som Gary. Liksom. Han är helt makalös. Han slår alla. Liksom. Det är ingen som kommer ens i närheten. Liksom. Det är bara, man känner, när Gary spelar, då känner man det hela kroppen. Liksom. Det är skillnad mot alla andra gitarrister som man lyssnar på idag. Liksom. Som är bara liksom flash och titta här, jag kan göra de här tapping-grejerna och allt det. Det är så tråkigt som man bara kräks. Men Gary, han lirar alltid med kropp och själ. Liksom. Det är det som är det viktigaste. Det spelar ingen roll hur många toner man kan. Det bara, jag menar, Gary spelar 2-3 toner så det räcker det för att krossa alla andra. Liksom. Så enkelt är det. Liksom.
...1979 är Thin Lizzy större än någonsin. Då försvinner Gary Moore spårlöst under en USA-turné.
Disaster. I think we all realize that now. It's a total disaster. The band was on the crest of a wave in America at the time. And I think maybe if Gary stayed with the band, we could have broke through in America. It was like just disaster time when he walked out.
Okay. But he was forgetting the words of the songs because he was a bit out of it from the night before. We were already having a row on stage by this stage because we started to play one song and it got to the guitar solo and he sung another verse. So I'm going, hey, fuck off. Excuse me. And he's going, no, you fuck off. And the kids at the front are going, you guys suck. You guys are shit. That was the gig. It was a bad night. You know, the overall thing was it was just like, you know, the party was, parties were becoming more important than the gig. The party after the gig was becoming more important than the gig. And when it gets to that point for me, I'm not interested. Mm. And it wasn't a good thing that I did, but I felt at the time that was the only way I could deal with it. I was really unhappy going on stage and the band was falling apart for me. You know, I don't want to like put Phil down because I know he had a problem. But for me, it was a nightmare to play live at that point with the band. It was just getting worse. From being a super tight band, it was just turning into a bit of a mess, really. And then the last gig was Day at the Green in San Francisco. And it was a huge, you know, the big stadium in Oakland. And he was losing it that day. He kicked the microphone stand over. He was in such, just knocked, flying. Mm. And that was the day I left.
Obviously, we had to get a guitar player in. Midgeur was drafted in very quickly. He was sent over on Concord to play the gig, so. But, you know, it was just one of those things. Gary wasn't happy and everything seemed to come to a head a couple of nights before he walked out, you know.
Ännu en gång är man tvungen att hitta en ny gitarrist. Thin Lizzy satsar på ett nytt grepp med bluesgitarristen Snowy White. Och för att bredda soundet inkallas en keyboardist.
I think Phil was always very keen to move with the time, so he just basically thought, well, he liked the texture that the keyboard was adding to the sound, and he decided that they were going to get a full-time keyboard player.
And he came in and he added a lot to those later albums as well, you know. He was great.
I was just in the right place at the right time. Long hair, you know, into rock and roll. And I said, absolutely, an audition would be great. So I went down on the train one day and met Phil, and they'd just started the Chinatown album.
Stand a chance if you go down in Chinatown. Then you don't stand a chance if you go down in Chinatown. Chinatown, it's a different scene. There are people there, they are so obscene. If you see what I mean, sold you the dream down in Chinatown. What goes up, it must come down. With Thin Lizzy, you played the Johannes Wolf's Ice Stadium for 5 consecutive years, a feat no other band has managed, actually.
Really?
79, 80, 81, 82, and 83. What do you remember from those gigs?
Well, you know what they say, if you can remember, you probably weren't there. it was always a great gig. You know, it's the one thing about the Swedish audience that it's a rock and roll audience, where I remember walking into the Ice Stadium and the audience is just powered up and ready to go.
The audience in Stockholm is one of our five audiences. The best in Sweden, that's where I want to stay tonight.
Are you ready? Are you ready?
The reason Sweden was sort of special, basically because we had such a good time when we were here. So it's actually nice to come back and have a look around here and try and remember 1977, you know. Bits of it I can actually remember, like this thing up here, that big tall thing. I don't know what it is, but I remember that because it was going up and down all night while we were playing. Sweden's very special to Lizzie for a lot of different reasons.
mainly because of the people and the way that we've been treated when we've any time we've toured here. And I found it since with any band I've played with over here. I spend a lot of time in Sweden. I have a studio here. My production company and my business partner are based in Stockholm. So I know the town really pretty well now. But I think it was basically down to the warmth of the people here, which you don't get everywhere, you know. Very laid-back people. After the gig, I can't remember an awful lot about it because we probably, in those days, we were partying fairly heavily. So I'm sure we all went to the hotel, got changed, and went to the club, got into more trouble, and so that was Lizzie for you, wasn't it, really? Down from the glen came the marching men with their shields and their swords to fight the fight they believed to be right, overthrow the overlords. To the town where there was plenty, they brought thunder, sword and flame. When they left, the town was empty. Children would never play again. Snowy is a great player, great blues player, but he didn't have the get up and go to play live rock and roll like that. He's, you know, he'd rather stand there and play. Doesn't take away from his playing, just wasn't right for the band or the image or anything.
Very strange situation, especially with Snowy White leaving and Gary Moore leaving and all that. But sometimes, you know, I mean, they wanted to leave. It wasn't, you know, they weren't always pushed. That was just part of the setup, you know. If something went wrong and there was a problem, another guitar player would be in next week, and that was the way it was.
1982 har desperationen ett krampaktigt grepp om Thin Lizzy. Krympande skivförsäljning har försatt bandet i skuld. Phil Lynott vill göra sig av med Snowy White som han tycker har fel inställning. En uppgiven Snowy White avgår frivilligt. Ännu mer kritiskt blir det när den andra gitarristen också vill gå sin väg.
I actually called up Phil and I told him that he and I needed a meeting because I felt I couldn't go on any longer. It had all gotten way out of hand, and I felt that we had worked way too hard for too many years to, you know, drag the name down with either bad performances or bad albums or bad whatever, you know. And I was having a hard time climbing on the stage every night at that point. And I looked at Phil, and I knew that he was too, but. Phil had the constitution of a bull, man. I mean, he could be on fire and he would still walk on the stage. But, you know, I'd had the meeting with Phil. It was before the Thunder and Lightning thing, and I told him, I said, I gotta go, man. You know, this is doing me in. You know, because I figured I had a choice, you know, try to get my shit back together again, and that's the way I chose. But, you know, Phil had a great way of talking people into things, and he didn't want to let it go. And I had all the intentions of quitting the band right then and there. And all of a sudden, when I walked out of his house, I'd agreed to do another album with a new guitar player who turned out to be John Sykes, and another world tour. And the door slammed behind me, and I thought, what the hell happened there? I was going to quit the band, and now I've got another world tour and album to do.
Oh,
I used to play Thin Lizzy covers in a band called Street Fighter. A few, like, you know, 78, 79, something like that. And then a couple of years later, well, you know, Thunder and Lightning happened and I managed to get in the band. And it was a fantastic thing, actually. The thrill of my whole musical career, the biggest highlight was being asked to join Thin Lizzy, you know? Really great. Lizzy for me was, it was more of a band thing. It was the real deal. And to be honest with you, I've never met anybody like Philip in my life. You know, I mean, he was the real thing, the epitome of a rock and roll star. You know, he was the man, and he didn't make any bones about it. He lived every second of it. And for me as a young man coming into the band, it was quite overwhelming and like a dream come true, you know? So it was a fantastic time for me. I mean, Whitesnake was good too. I had some great times with Whitesnake, but I always preferred Thin Lizzy as a band than Whitesnake, always.
Med John Sykes som Thin Lizzys senaste gitarrist spelar man in albumet Thunder and Lightning, deras största succé på flera år. Men innan utgivningen har gruppens manager bestämt att Thin Lizzy ska upplösas. En hejdundrande avskedsturné ska vara knepet som gör att man kan betala bandets skulder.
We did a year of farewell concerts, and after that, you know, we were supposed to break up and leave it at that. But I was always under the impression that after that year, we might get a new lease of life or something with John Sykes in the band and all that. And maybe, you know, do another record after Thunder and Lightning and maybe go back and do more tours. But that never actually happened.
I've got to give it up. I've got to give it up. That's the way. I've got to give it up. I've got to give it up. That's the way.
79 era when we were in Paris doing the Black Rose album. It was strange. All of a sudden, and I don't know how it happened, but all of a sudden there were just sort of drug dealers around the band the whole time we were there. Just kind of, you know, here's a pile of coke and here's a pile of smack and bada bing, bada boom, and you know, you end up, yeah, isn't this great, cool, man? You end up doing it.
The drugs came in a number of ways. One, recreational. Everybody tries drugs when they're young. Two, necessity. In other words, he needed something to keep him going when he had to play gig after gig after gig after gig. It's very demanding. It's like, you know, asking a footballer to play, you know, 5 matches a week.
I think maybe some of the problems with really us being on the road constantly for 11 years. I mean, we never came off the road. I think the only time we ever came off the road really was to do an album.
I think many people in the music business have been down that old dark road, you know? You know, a little bit becomes a little bit more and a bit more and a bit more, and before you know it, you've cultivated a really big habit, you know?
You're always thinking that I can walk away from this thing, you know? And some people can, and a lot of people, they get caught up in the web, you know, and there's no walking away from it. You know, all of a sudden you find yourself, you're in the pain barrier now. And whatever you kind of had going before, any good thing you had going before is soon to get eaten up. And that's pretty much what happened to us.
Because the thing is, when you're somebody like Phil Lynott, the party never fucking ends, because people are constantly coming to the house, constantly coming to the front door. You know, I mean, I used to be there. I'd see them coming. You know, people would come, hang out, party, leave, and then 3 hours later, another batch of different people would show up. Just friends, people that wanted to come and hang out and party. But the problem was Phil didn't, he never turned anybody away.
I just thought maybe, you know, we should maybe really take a long break, and maybe Phil should go in maybe and sort of dry out. Maybe I should go in and dry out as well, you know. We should have taken a long break and then sort of maybe get back together again.
But Philip always had this attitude like, you know, I got it licked. I can get rid of all this when I feel like it, you know?
you know, he went from being like this really energetic workaholic guy. It was a long decline. Didn't just happen overnight. One time he was just full of energy. He'd be the first one up in the morning. He'd be like our mother. He'd be cooking breakfast for us all, you know, and stuff. And he'd be in the studio long after everyone else had finished. And he'd be first in the next day. He'd spend 7 hours doing a rough guide vocal, writing the lyrics as he went along with a big spliff in his mouth. And just, that's how he was. He was just full of it. He worked harder than anybody I ever met at that time.
It was becoming kind of obvious that he wasn't well.
He was always the guy that could do more than anybody and always come out on top at the end, every time. He was the Mike Tyson of rock and roll.
Phil came to Ireland when I was doing the Emerald Isles video to sing on Parisian walkways. We had actually just made up as friends again. We hadn't seen each other, I remember, for 4 years. There was a big thing between us. And I said, do you want to come over and, you know, do this thing at, you know, the Ulster Hall in Belfast? And he said, yeah, yeah. And then I told him about the song Out in the Fields. And I said, do you want to do this together as a single? And he said, yeah, yeah, yeah. But Phil was very involved in that whole thing. I mean, I wrote the whole song, but Phil really added a hell of a lot to it in terms of, you know, just having his voice and the whole imagery of the thing. Like, Phil came up with the whole kind of imagery of the, you know, the kind of soldiers' jackets and the whole thing of putting it across in a commercial way. So he was very responsible. I don't think, if I'd recorded that on my own, I don't think it would have been a hit, to be honest.
It doesn't matter if you're wrong or if you're right. It makes no difference if you're black or if you're white. Stop the bullet from a gun. In the field, the fighting has begun. On the street, the falling one by one. Fathers, thousands more will die each day. Death is just a heartbeat away.
You know, I'm very happy that we were able to do that. It was an opportunity, our last opportunity as it turned out, to work together. So it was good that we did it.
That's the way Phil was. He could take all this abuse and yet look to people that he was okay. At the end of the day, it was much too late. It was too late when he realized himself that it was too far gone. And he never really asked for help until it was much too late.
You know, it all came to a crashing end, unfortunately.
Before he died, I was cleaning his face one day and he said, "Merciful Jesus, what have I done to you?" I'll never forget them words. Them words stay with me for the rest of my life. It was then he realized that he was losing it. And I remember a priest coming in and he had collar on. I said, "What have you come for? You'll frighten him. Go away." He said he asked for me.
But when the actual call came in that he had just died, I really just kind of sat on the steps and I cried. You know, it wasn't the bass player or the singer that has died now. It's one of your best friends. You know, it's completely devastating when something like that happens.
I was in Tenerife, and
my wife at the time's parents were living there, and her dad, her father, told me, "Oh, your friend's not very well." I went, "Well, what do you mean?" And he told me he'd read about Phil in the paper, that Phil had been taken to hospital. So I was calling up the office every day to find out what was happening, and then they told me he was getting better. So I suddenly relaxed about it, and I thought, oh yeah. But then I had this bad feeling. And then you get the papers over there a day late. So on Monday, we got the Sunday papers, and my wife at the time, she picked it up, she went, oh, and I saw her face, and I knew exactly what had happened. And I'd had this dream the night before about a black cat being strangled, like with a cord around its neck. I had this really bad feeling.
I still could cry about it today if I think too much about it. That's how much he impacted my life, you know. Phil was like a family member to me, you know.
Thin Lizzys musikskatt har aldrig tappat sin lyster. Gruppens låtar lever vidare genom nya versioner inspelade av så vitt skilda artister som Bon Jovi, The Smashing Pumpkins, Iron Maiden, The Cardigans, Def Leppard och Metallica.
I'd say Phil Lynott is one of my, if not my favorite songwriter. I think the stuff he wrote was amazing. The sadness, it never ceases.
Oh, I'm still in love with you. Phil's one of the greatest songwriters of the time, you know, of his time. His songs still stand up today. The songs are timeless. They're fantastic. They're classics. He wrote so many classics, man. It's unbelievable. I don't know if he was even aware how great he was, you know.
I just think Phil just loved music so much. He just lived for music. And that gave him the ability to write all these fantastic songs.
He was probably one of the nicest guys you could ever meet that would take the shirt off his back to try to help you. If you had a problem, boom, I'll be there, man, I'll help you. You're having a problem with that, I'm on your side. I got your back. He was that kind of guy.
Phil's music's gonna live forever, and he deserves to be credited with a fantastic, with an outrageous amount of credit for this, for what he's given to everybody, his music and everything.
I'd like to welcome you into White Horses. This is the house that Philip, when he was a little boy, promised me. He'd buy me a big, big house, and this is the house that he bought me for my 50th birthday, called White Horses. You're welcome to come in and have a look at Philip's memorabilia and show it to all his fans in Sweden, please. Ooh, I'm gonna keep on loving. Is this the end? Still in love with you. I get fans from all over the world, sometimes busloads. And sometimes we look out the window and people are sitting on that wall there, look. And I come out and I speak to them. I say, have you been visiting Philip? And they say, yes. I say, come on in. And I get people from Japan, Canada, Australia, you name it. There's not a country. Basque country, they brought me their flag. And it's just amazing how far his music has traveled and how much he's loved. I find it interesting speaking to them, and they'll tell me their favorite tune. And, oh, I met Philip, I saw him on stage, and my father took me to the show. And it goes on and on. It's so interesting. What can I say? It's a, they give to me a great, great amount of comfort, and I send them away with memories. Most of them do a pilgrimage to his grave, but at the end of the day, when they end up here, they think they're so happy, and they send me photographs of their children, and they come back, some come back, and then they send me Christmas cards and stuff. And I have hundreds of friends, all because of Philip. As well as my own friends, of course. Okay, thank you. Thank you.